Welcome back to Sociology of Law. Today we're going to conclude our discussion of legislation and the creation of new moral rules by discussing some patterns in the evolution of sex laws in America. And to modern people, the idea of regulating sex and sexuality might seem a little bit odd, because why would you regulate private conduct? Or at least it raises the question of whether we should be regulating private conduct. But not every society in history has considered sex to be solely a matter of private conduct. For example, the early Puritan colonies in America viewed sex as a public matter. There was no distinction between public and private sexual behavior, because in the small, tight-knit community, A, people knew each other's business, and B, their religious beliefs told them that, you know, one person's sin could affect the entire community. So if you committed adultery, you might be putting the entire community at risk of God's wrath. They feared collective liability from the divine. But in a lot of ways, the Puritans were an exception to the way Americans historically thought about these things. And if you look a little bit later at the 19th century US, we see that there is a distinction between public and private sexual behavior. And in the 19th century, we see this pattern that the law is only concerned with public offenses. So the idea is that the law is only going to regulate your sexual behavior if it intrudes upon the public sphere and threatens to cause some sort of scandal. So you see these laws on the books in different states condemning not adultery, but open and notorious adultery. The idea was, you could get away with cheating on your spouse, and that's your business and your spouse's business. But as long as you keep it on the down low, you can't flaunt that in public. So if you are married and you're openly living with another person besides your spouse, then it becomes a legal problem. One glaring exception, though, to this tendency to regulate public sexuality was the widespread toleration of prostitution. Now, prostitution was technically illegal in the 1800s, but it was de facto tolerated everywhere. Like, you see these old westerns where, the cowboy goes into the town and they go into the saloon, and on the top floor of the saloon there's a brothel, and that's fairly accurate. Most of these frontier towns had brothels. Most of the eastern cities also had brothels. In 1865, there was a census of the number of brothels in New York City. There were 599 brothels in New York City. And keep in mind, this is a time, more than a century ago, when New York's population was much, much smaller than it is today. So this city was crowded with brothels relative to the number of people who lived there. And you had this weird situation where in some towns and cities in the US, there were actually local ordinances and legal regulations governing brothels. So you would have a condition where a state law would say brothels are illegal, and then a city law would say, well, here's some laws to regulate the hours and locations of this illegal thing. It's a contradiction. You can't legally regulate something that's illegal, but people did it anyway. So in the late 1800s, starting around 1870, and going on into the early 1900s, we see this period of moral crusades aimed at increasing regulation of sex and reproduction. And this is just a really interesting period in U.S. history, because if you remember, this is the same period when we get our first moral crusades against drugs and alcohol, resulting in eventually prohibition and the criminalization of heroin and cocaine, and the last one at the tail end of this period was marijuana. So it's like something about the late 19th century, early 20th century in America that just generated these social movements and this strong moralizing concern with regulating vice and trying to ferret out these social problems. This same period saw crusades against obscenity and vice and increasing regulations on what sort of images you could show. It saw the first right to life movement, which is actually led by doctors and first generation feminists. So the first legal regulations to abortion happened during this period. And you see this moral crusade against prostitution. And the big theme of this moral crusade was that prostitution is a kind of social disease. They use this language of disease pretty often, and it's not a coincidence, because sex can spread sexually transmitted diseases, and this is the age before penicillin. There's no antibiotics, there's no vaccines. And so a lot of these men who are going to brothels are picking up sexually transmitted diseases and bringing them home to their wives. So there was an actual disease component to this, but there's also this rhetoric of it being a social disease, a disease of the body politic that was weakening families and weakening society. And this moral crusade plugged along for decades, but it had its greatest success when it generated a moral panic. And this moral panic happened in the early 1900s. It was called the White Slavery Panic. And the allegation here was that thousands and thousands of white women, which of course, white women garnered more concern from the white population, thousands and thousands of women were being kidnapped and forced into sexual slavery, and that these brothels all throughout the country were stocked with not people who were working there more or less voluntarily, but literal sex slaves, and you sell these crazy statistics like 60,000 girls had been kidnapped over the course of a year and sold into sex slavery. Well, this moral panic was largely unfounded. I mean, it might have happened now and again that someone was abducted and forced into prostitution, but it was a very rare thing. Certainly, there was not 60,000 girls in America being forced into prostitution. There's very little evidence there was any kind of organized trafficking going on at all. But people believed there was, and there were dime novels and books and sensational stories and flyers and all this propaganda to convince people that this was a major threat. You know, your daughter might be the next one kidnapped and sold to a brothel. Your sister might be the next one kidnapped and sold to a brothel. If you're a woman, you might be kidnapped and sold to a brothel. And so you had this great fear over what they called white slavery, and that led to some of the first great pushes to more strictly regulate prostitution. And in 1910 and 20, it culminated in what they called the Red Light Abatement Movement. Red light districts were parts of cities where brothels were allowed. Not maybe according to the written law, but de facto they were allowed. Well, the Red Light Abatement Movement was a movement to purge all the cities in America of their red light districts, to say there's no safe place for brothels to exist. And this is the movement that cleared out brothels from most cities and drove prostitution underground. This is why, and most of the time since then, prostitution is something you associate with people walking the streets, prostitutes operating under highway overpasses or walking down the streets at night, because brothels are, for the most part, a thing of the past. Also in 1910, you saw the creation of the Mann Act, which was an act that was a direct reaction to the white slave moral panic and meant to combat this alleged sex trafficking, which was supposedly going on in large amounts. This act made it a felony to transport a woman across state lines for immoral purposes. Now, note how broad and vague that law is. It doesn't make it a felony to transport someone across state lines for the purposes of prostitution. It says no, for immoral purposes. Well, immoral is something that varies a lot depending on who you are and where you're at, and it leaves a lot of room for judges and juries and prosecutors to decide whether or not you violated this act. So even though this act was meant to combat sex trafficking, it was used in effect to prosecute things like premarital sex, extramarital sex, underage sex, or statutory rape, and it was used in the South especially to prosecute interracial relationships. For example, the famous boxer Jack Johnson, who married a white woman, he was prosecuted under this act because he was transporting her for immoral purposes, the immorality being a mixed-race relationship. So you see, at the start of the 20th century, this increase in the regulation of private sexual conduct. And it stays this way for a big chunk of that century until you get to the 1960s. In the 1960s, especially for sexuality, we had major, major upheavals. We had the creation of the birth control pill, the first effective contraception that women could control themselves, and that drove a big wedge between sexual behavior and reproduction. Whereas before, getting pregnant was closely tied to having sex. Now you could have sex all the time and have very, very little risk of getting pregnant. You also saw changes in the economy, with more and more women being drawn into the workforce, feeding the women's liberation movement, with more and more women who were financially independent of men and campaigning for greater equality in the workplace and greater opportunities outside the home. And this included greater freedom of their own sexuality. And you saw, as part of the youth culture of the 1960s, a move towards greater sexual freedom. Hippies were big on what they called free love. And all these trends fed into what they call the sexual revolution, this move towards a much more sexually open society where extramarital sex was not stigmatized, where premarital sex was not stigmatized, and where people could have promiscuous sex outside of the confines of marriage with little threat of pregnancy, also little threat of disease. This is the period after antibiotics have helped cure a lot of sexually transmitted diseases and before AIDS erupted. So sex was safe for one of the first times in history and relatively consequence-free. And so we see a lot of pushes in this period against the regulation of sex and reproduction. And going into the 1970s, we see striking down of various laws regulating contraceptives, we see striking down of laws regulating abortion, and we see a greater acceptance of extramarital and premarital sex. And I would say the trend was similar for the legal treatment of homosexuality, with one major exception. Homosexuality had never been unregulated, whereas in the 19th century, homosexuality had always been punished, at least on the books, and often in practice. And usually this took the form of what they call anti-sodomy laws, and legal documents define sodomy in different ways. Usually it refers to anal sex and mostly punishes male homosexuality. Well, we've had anti-sodomy laws on the books in England since as old as the 1500s, and like many things from this earlier period in history, punishments for this were brutal. One particularly terrible punishment was something they called the pear of anguish. It was a pear-shaped mechanical device that would be inserted into the convicted sodomite's anus, And this device had four metal leaves with sharp edges. And once it was inserted, they would unscrew it, and these leaves would open up and greatly damage the person's insides, probably killing them in a very horrible way. And in a way that was meant to be an ironic, let the punishment fit the crime. And homosexuality remained a felony in the U.S. up until the 1960s. And if you were publicly gay, you were an admitted criminal. But along with the sexual revolution of the 1960s and 70s, there also emerged the gay rights movement, especially in the 1970s, when you started getting critical masses of gay people living in certain communities. So San Francisco is a famous center of gay community. And this critical mass allowed people to have a gay lifestyle. You could have gay bars. You could have gay communities where people had a common identity and cooperated in their own interest. This is when you start getting the gay rights movement, leading to more and more acceptance of homosexuality in American society, and leading to public figures being openly gay, and leading to less enforcement of laws that used to be enforced against homosexuality. These were on their way to becoming dead letter laws even before they were officially overturned, which is why it wasn't until 2003 that we had a case of somebody being prosecuted that could go to the Supreme Court, and in which the Supreme Court could strike down any state laws against consensual and private sodomy. So as of 2003, homosexual sex has been decriminalized both in fact and on the books. And in 2015, these trends continued with the Obergefell versus Hodges decision of the Supreme Court, which struck down any laws against same-sex marriage. So if we were to sum up the recent trends in American society, it's law retreating from consensual sex. If the trend at the end of the 19th century was law was increasingly regulating consensual sex, now that trend's going in the opposite direction. On the other hand, we've seen increasing regulation of non-consensual sex, greater concern with enforcing laws against rape and sexual assault, campaigns to increase the prosecution for these offenses, campaigns to educate against these offenses, to instruct people that no means no. We've seen, for example, the first laws against spousal rape. Before that, sometimes there were a lot of state laws that specified to be guilty of rape, you had to not be married to the victim. Nowadays, all of those laws have been struck down. You can be guilty of raping someone you're married to. And this overall evolution has been described as a move towards an egalitarian model of sex. And you could explain this with society becoming both more individualistic and men and women becoming more equal in their status. And the law has reacted now by giving people more individual freedom over their sexuality and increasingly viewing this as a private matter for people. But at the same time, the law is becoming more strict towards sexual predation and sexual coercion. Again, you could explain that with the greater equality between the sexes now than 40, 50 years ago. There's stricter punishment for crimes that predominantly victimize women. Where you get gray areas in this is where people disagree over the extent to which something is egalitarian. And so prostitution remains one of those gray areas. We have seen some limited return of prostitution being legalized in Nevada, where brothels are now legal. But for the most part, it remains criminalized in most American states. And partly because the argument in favor of keeping it criminalized is that it's an exploitative kind of sexuality. Even if it's technically an economic transaction with two consenting parties, the idea is that the prostitute's probably not there fully by choice. She might be in desperate circumstances or being abused and controlled by a pimp. Versus others who say, well, this is actually a job, and these people, first of all, you shouldn't even call them prostitutes. You should call them sex workers, and they should have all the rights and regulations of people in other jobs, too, and should be respected. So that's one debate there, and it hinges on the extent to which this is something that is or could be an egalitarian type of exchange versus something that's inherently exploitative and inegalitarian.